old school. Today, hey Rikers, welcome back to your number one rugby podcast. You know what it is, it's Juan de Jong, live and direct, and next to me is the one and only...
Hey Sport, hey Sront, hey Bounce on the ground, it's Rudy Pace, it's Rudy Pace.
Pace, how are you doing? You good?
Boyki, I am fantastic. Yes. I'm looking good, I'm feeling good. It's episode 40.
Episode 40, special. We'll get into it later on.
Otherwise,
but yeah, look where we are. First of all, in the Cheetah's Den, live in Bloemfontein, can you believe?
Annie Bloem Vegas, yes. Special to be here. Actually, when we walked in your partner, I got some memories. Yeah, I spent a few months or a year. I spent being part of the Cheetah's franchise. So really good back to be back in Bloem.
100%, yeah.
And how are you?
I'm good, eh? So we're in Bloemfontein, obviously. Uh-huh. So rugby down here to play a couple of games. Exciting times, eh?
Okay.
So coaching staff, you know, Heinrich and Aaron Joubert and myself, which charging it up the youngsters, eh?
Okay,
so
today
we're... Yes.
Okay.
A little bit of a touch of love. And yourself, came to visit, quick visit.
Quick visit in and out, obviously excited. Our guest guys on this show, we had to make the effort, partner.
We have to.
It's from cardinale belang.
That's why I've worked cardinale belang. Yeah. So exciting, yeah.
Exciting. I can't wait to speak to him, actually. We're obviously going to give the lineup and that sort of thing now. But just phenomenal what he achieved and who he is. And
we'll get to the lineup now and you can spill that beans.
Okay.
But before we get there, let's talk about the big stuff. Hey guys, Behind the Ruck is powered by Kruger International Asset and Wealth Management. Go check the barcode as the squeeze bag pops up. You know what the deal, eh? So make sure they can do for you what they've done for the two of us, eh? So go check them out. And also, it's powered and brought you by our official betting partner, Lulabet in the corner. Like always, nothing has changed, eh? So yeah, go check them out as well. And partner... Hey,
exciting news.
Look at that.
Ruckers, we have a new official apparel sponsor on Behind the Ruck.
Back to school, you know, January.
Back to reality.
Back to the old school.
And
you're fantastic, eh, partner?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I'm excited, to see the relationship and the collab with them. It's absolutely fantastic, eh? For them to see something in us, you know, moving us and making sure we look good.
We look good.
And
Ruckers, obviously, old school is on board with Behind the Ruck.
Yeah.
It just makes sense. Mm. Old school is a rugby brand and we are the Ruckers.
Mm.
So, okay.
The Ruckers is getting there.
Salt, pepper.
Like a puzzle.
Like that.
Yeah. We're back to school. Not the new school. We retired. We old school. But we'll get into that. Yeah.
But I must say, I am extremely excited, partner.
Yeah.
The fact that we're going to look good. We're going to be dressed in old school apparel.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
That's exciting news. Yeah. So guys, go check them out. What a journey they've had. It's only been a couple of years, 5 years. Yeah. They've got, founders. That's doing fantastic work over there. Well, more information as the episodes grow.
Yes,
and
Ruckers, as the international season will come, we will promote and make sure that you do not go to a braai without your old school jersey.
Yeah.
Luister, guys, ons het tyd. We got time in our hands. We got time to get our old school jersey. So once the Springbok kicks off and you go to the braai and people invite you, you are dressed to impress and you're ready.
Yeah, spark the Ruckers interest.
Okay, lekker dankie, DJ.
Talk to me. Line this thing up. Let's get the ducks in a row, yeah, because you know what's happening.
Our lineup today is nice, simple, easy, and exciting.
Mm.
Okay, boyki, we have got news and updates. Okay, we're going to talk about that. Then we got our guest speaker, none other than the magician legend, Ruan Pienaar. Ruan Pienaar, Ruckers, we got on the zone. Piney will be here in the studio.
Episode 40 for the 40-year-old, still doing it, still looking fresh.
Hey man, loop nog.
Yeah.
Huh?
Is there a Statue of Liberty somewhere?
When I landed in Bloem, I was waiting for the statue.
Yes.
But they're working on it apparently.
Okay, when he retires.
So Ruckers, Ruan Pienaar, exciting, massive, big deal. Sorry, partner.
Okay.
Check then after Piney, we're going to talk a bit about the results, the weekend, the fixtures, the upcoming URC fixtures, and then our Lulabet predictions.
You know what it is.
And that is episode 40. What a milestone, boyki.
What a milestone, yeah. Hey.
40 weke van jou.
Yeah?
40 weke van jou.
It's long, but it's been good, eh?
It's been brilliant.
It's been good. Yeah. Let's cover it.
You want to go into the news?
Let's get the news and updates quickly. There's a couple of things. Starting off, with Super Rugby.
Super Rugby, the most thing that actually stood out for me was TJ Perenara.
Yes.
Equals Julian Savia's try scoring record.
Yeah. And he's looking in incredible form. Obviously, he's going to play a lot now with Cam Roygaard out for a little bit. Yeah.
So that record will be smashed rather soon.
Yeah, I think so.
Yes, I think so, definitely.
4-9. The Nines are taking over, man.
And especially the way the Hurricanes are playing partner.
It's
an attractive brand of rugby, and they're on top of the world. Down under.
Yeah. And talking about down under, there's another guy that signs for the Rebels.
Ooh, Kirtley Billy's back.
He's back.
Magician.
Wallabies.
Signed with a force. Signed with the Force.
Is the Force strong?
Western Force. The Force is strong. Yeah. Now that Kirtley Bill is there.
It's going to be good to see him back. Yeah, obviously Australia is struggling a little bit, especially with the Hooper at the sevens. Kirtley Bill coming back. So Smith. He
must be happy.
Yeah, he must
be super
happy.
He must definitely
be happy.
One of my all-time favorite players.
Mm-hmm.
I just liked what he can do and how he can create.
Young as well.
He started 18. Very young. So Kirtley Bill, welcome back. We are excited to see you on our TV. So okay.
Get cracking. And then the Young Bloods.
There was a youngster, Tian Jacobs, under 20.
Yeah, under 20 squad is out there. So he's obviously playing in France for Biarritz. Yeah, it's good to see Bafana getting him into the squad, but the squad is looking good. And also our guy from a couple of episodes.
J.C. Mars. Made it. Congratulations,
young man.
We're
fully behind you. We're fully behind, especially the SN20, the whole squad, because it's a tough couple of games in Australia, playing New Zealand.
Good
Australia,
learning curve for the boys. And hopefully this year will be the year that we bring that trophy home again.
Home, yeah. Bring it home.
Or Kassies from four lessons in Africa.
Prop four.
Hey!
Nou, soos ek geëet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Boykie, let's wait no time.
Yeah.
Let's get to the main man. Okay?
Yes,
main peanut in the pakkie.
Main peanut, pine in the pakkie. Okay? There we go. Up next,
Ruan Pienaar. Rakkers.
Can you believe it? Mm? We're excited and we're nervous and everything. Mm?
Rakkers, this is actually take two.
It's take two.
With our guest. What happened?
We didn't press record on the mics.
Okay.
But it is what it is.
It's fine.
But now, we got the big man in the house. And he's a legend. He's got all the patience in the world.
Finally, welcome to Behind the Ruck. Sorry, we got to do everything all over again, meneer.
Awesome. We don't see you in Bloom Vegas often enough. So, happy to do it a second time.
How are you doing? Are you good?
I'm good, yeah. No complaints. All well, body still breathing. So yeah, no complaints. All going well there in Bloomies.
Yeah, Bloom Vegas, eh?
Mm. And Piney, obviously, I want to start at the Cheetahs currently.
Yeah.
Obviously, unfortunately, sorry about the loss at Clermont.
Yeah,
you guys obviously put up a really good fight. Let's talk about Cheetahs rugby, current Cheetahs rugby, where the Cheetahs are finding themselves and how you guys are trying to do the best thing for Cheetahs rugby at the moment.
Just like you mentioned now, last weekend had a tough loss against Clermont. I thought the guys showed really good character, had a nice fight back in that second half. But yeah, I just feel like we don't get exposed to the level of rugby often enough. Unfortunately, we're not playing at that level week in, week out, which is a bit of a pity. But yeah, I know the guys behind the scenes are fighting really hard to find us a permanent spot in a top flight competition. But you've played here, Pagey. The people keep fighting. It's a great union to be a part of. Great characters. It's still enjoyable to play rugby for the Cheetahs.
Yeah, and just what a game it was. You guys were fighting back, trying to get into it. I mean, it's always tough playing in Clermont with that fantastic crowd. But it is what it is. Now you guys playing in the SA Cup. Yeah. Obviously, you play the Kings now. How's the journey been, the challenge been in this competition, being the Currie Cup champions, you know, the favourites for this competition?
It's been good. We've had a few good performances, obviously a loss against the Pumas a couple of weeks ago. But I think the boys are playing really well. For the coaches, again, it's another opportunity to give some of the youngsters a bit of exposure at this level. And I think the same for all the smaller unions that's taking part in the SA Cup. So I think there will be a lot of changes within the side every weekend. But it's great to give them exposure at this level. And hopefully, I think there's about five or six rounds left, and hopefully the guys can perform well. And I think there is a finalist in the SA Cup, and hopefully we can reach that. It's enjoyable.
Piney, I obviously have been telling my partner this. I've been having some dreams party. Yeah. I've been asking rugby people, God, please.
Yes.
Piney doesn't need to commit. Piney's still a contracted rugby player at this moment. But partner, imagine Cheetahs in Super Rugby.
Yeah, we said, Super Rugby. Saturday morning, 9:30, wake up, and it's the Hurricanes against the Cheetahs, and here we go.
And it's that brand of rugby that Cheetahs play, obviously, that fits perfectly, I think, with what the Super Rugby is about. I know we're not in that powers to be that makes the decisions. But it is a very nice idea, isn't it?
It's a great idea. But just on that, do you miss Super Rugby? Because you've obviously played Super 14. Do you play Super 12?
Yeah, it's a, I mean, it was an incredible tournament to be a part of. You guys know, wake up every morning as a schoolboy watching it. The only thing on a Friday and a Saturday you spoke about, you hardly did any schooling because all you wanted to know are the South African teams are doing on tour and everything. And then later on, pro rugby. I think from a Cheetahs point of view, it's been tough. I think with COVID happening in 2019, being kicked out of Super Rugby a couple of years prior to that, then being kicked out of Pro Rugby. It's hard, and it's been a bit of a fight and a slog over here, but somehow the guys have kept on fighting. Also within that, we lost a lot of our good players that used to play at the Cheetahs going abroad. Yeah. Guys like Jasper Wiese and all those guys who decided to go on and achieve great things. So it would have been nice to still have that core group guys. The guys are still fighting. We've got a decent squad at the moment. The Cheetahs will always be there or thereabouts. It's everyone's second team in the country. So hopefully we can find a spot in either Super Rugby or URC, just somewhere where people can come and watch the Cheetahs perform against top flight teams.
And have the big five. We've got the big five. Safari is a big five. Rugby is a big five. We need the big five in competitions. Let's go to Cheetahs Rugby. Obviously, you just said now the challenges when it comes to Cheetahs Rugby in Bloemfontein. What is the mindset like? Is the guys very positive? Because it looked positive, especially looking at your games, you know, getting a couple of upsets, especially against a good team like the Sharks as well. And also the fans as well. What is the vibe like in Bloemfontein trying to get yourself back into the top five?
I think as players, we speak about it quite a lot. I think we know the importance of the Cheetahs doing well, not only for Bloem, but for the region and the platteland around the city. So, we know we've got a bit of a responsibility to perform well and get people back in the seats in Bloemfontein. But I think in saying that, we do need a top flight competition for people to come back here. But, people in Central South Africa is incredibly passionate about rugby and the Cheetahs. And hopefully we can fight our way back into a top flight competition again. I think it's important for South African rugby to realize the importance of Cheetahs in a top flight competition. Yeah. Hopefully that will happen in the near future. So, we'll just be nice to see the stadium packed again and see all the people and supporters to come out and support
100%, us. 100%, the history around it. Hey, when I walk in, I'm still nervous.
But when we came in here this morning, I loved everything. I mean, there's so many changes, even Piney, that's happened to the stadium and the inside of the locker rooms and how professional the setup still is. Yeah. It's still at a very elite level. So we cannot let that go to waste. There's so many talent in the central part of South Africa and we must do everything possible to make sure that the Cheetahs play Tabua.
The talent, the schools that comes from here, it's important.
And I must say, Piney, the Cheetahs, in my experience, the Cheetahs are excellent at finding that rough diamonds and redefining them and into something like a Yassi, a Francois Venter at the
Ruan
time.
Pienaar,
Asiya Masuka, actually currently is playing fantastic rugby for the Sharkies. So there must be something that should be done. I don't know how. I'm not that smart partner. That's obviously something on the scouts.
We find a way.
But finally, let's look at your career. A fantastic. Is it 20 years? How long was the career?
Yeah, more or less,
24, 25-year career. Finally, let's start right at the start. Growing up in Bloemfontein, what was that like?
Yeah, incredible. I must say I was really fortunate to grow up in a loving home, supportive home, and for some reason just loved rugby, as all of us really do. I think it's in our DNA. It's what we love as South Africans. And like I mentioned in our first take, I grew up with Morne Steyn just around the corner. We went to the same primary school, and we were all in love with rugby from a young age, and played it at school. I tried everything: hockey, cricket, athletics, everything really. But for some reason, rugby was the one thing I enjoyed the most. And then had the privilege of going to Great College, which obviously historically You know, really good rugby school. I think still to my mother's disappointment because I hardly did any schooling, which is not great advice.
We listen
advice for advice for youngsters.
Yeah, yeah. We're always out there.
Unfortunately, everything worked out fine, but I hardly did any homework and stuff. So it was not a great time for my parents. Yeah. But anyway, I just fell in love with the game from a young age and went to Shimla's, played quite a few games for Shimla's, played for the Free State Junior Structures year before, and eventually going to the Sharks. So great memories. Just loved my time.
Yeah. Was there pressure actually from your dad as well, Gacy? Obviously, he's played for the Springboks 13, 14 times, you know, and we all like that. You want your little boy to become the next kind of you. Was there any pressure from him, you know, putting pressure onto you to achieve the things and get to the heights?
No, I must say he was really supportive. He never really put any pressure on me and to go training. I just loved it. So my primary school was 100 meters away from my house. So I spent a lot of time kicking and passing on my own and also with Mornay. I think there was a bit of pressure from outside. If you got selected for a Crane Week team or stuff like that, people would say, oh, but it's Gacy Pienaar's son.
Okay. Yeah.
So I think in more, and I managed to, I kon het goed hanteer because I think mentally I was prepared for it always. And when people said so, they actually motivated me to work harder.
You showed
so
him, yeah.
I always tried to be the fittest guy when there was fitness tests and tried to work harder than everyone, and I think that work ethic eventually helped me along the way. But I think there was more pressure from outside than from my parents' side. Mm.
And then, Piney, then you moved from the States, from the Bloomies, you moved to the Sharkies.
The Sharkies, Durban?
To the Durban Coastal. Box. And you said many Durban Box.
You wanted to see.
Let's talk about that transition, especially being a Bloom boy, going to a predominantly English culture down in Durban. Yeah. How did you transition into... what was a fun and loving time in Durbs?
Yeah, it was a tough decision. I mean, I was happy. Was staying with my parents. Je was goed word gewas. Je kom elke aand. Hy is dinges, as kos is lekker. But then the opportunity came to go to the Sharks. Kevin Putt gave me a call. And decided to go there. We had Michael Klaasens and Farley Ujic at the Free State at that stage. And I thought my way into senior rugby will maybe progress a bit quicker at the Sharks. And I had an incredible time there. I was a bit nervous for the Engels. like it's coming from Bloom, growing Bloomies Afrikaans, or was a bit more Afrikaans back then. So hardly spoke any English. And now we've got to go to Durban, which is predominantly English. But we had a great group of players, actually. A lot of Afrikaans-speaking guys within the team, which helped. Such a good time. Durban was an incredible place to live in back then. The Sharks brand and everything around it, I just loved it. I had such a good time.
And thinking about your career as well, because you played 9 and you played 10, which one did you kind of like and prefer? Because usually you see the 9s there a little bit, you know.
Seatbelt, put on your seatbelt, sir.
So you're a different type of 9, being tall, being physical, you know, playing 9 and also playing 10 a little bit.
Yeah, I grew up playing at 10 actually in primary school, and then once I joined Great College in grade 8. I put my name up at Flyoff and Scrumoff because I was so small. Because all these Northern Free State and Boersienkies from the Free State came in, and I was so tiny. And I decided to put my name in at Scrumoff as well for trials, and went decent, and just stayed there ever since. And then grade 10, all of a sudden after December holiday, I just shot up and got taller, and my grade 10 year rugby was decent, but I couldn't put one foot in front of the other. I was slow, and like the forwards ran around me with ease. It was just hard, and then eventually grew into my body. But I think that 9 has just always been the position I enjoyed the most, being in the middle of everything, having to make crucial decisions and stuff within a split second. I always just enjoyed playing 9.
Managing the game.
And the move to 10 sometimes, was that predominantly coaches asking you to do the job, or were you actually sometimes keen to actually play fly-off?
Nee, ek was meer as 'n proppie gebruik. But I enjoy fly-off. I must say, you're still involved with the decision making and sense of everything, and got to drive the team around and stuff. I enjoy. I think when you play in a position for a number of weeks, you sort of get settled and stuff. Yeah. So it was more sort of cover most of the time, or you were seen as an impact player. I remember with Brent Russell and those guys, they were seen as impact players. And I think eventually you sort of grow into that tag more than being a starter, especially at the national team that happened. But I mean, I enjoy playing both positions, but yeah, nine will always be my favorite.
And nine, especially, you got to go around the park. Mm. Okay. Nine in your 20s and nine in your late 30s. Is it a different
thing? and now in your 40s. It's hard. Yeah. I enjoy it. It's good. It's challenging. You know, the air here in Bloom is a thin. You can hardly breathe. It's nice. It keeps you fit. It keeps you young. And I think now with the youngsters coming through, you've got to challenge yourself every day to keep up. It's challenges I still enjoy.
Mm. Partner, actually, he speaks about fitness, Ruckus. I remember 2015. Mm. I used to think I was fit, right? Then we did repeat it. You remember with Coach Heineke every time? Yeah. And I couldn't catch Piney, buddy. And it frustrated me so much because I knew I was older. I was young. I think I was 24 at the time, just in the box mix. Yeah. And he could run. Yeah. Him and Forstrace, Morning Stein.
He's got the length, man. Usain Bolt's got that, you know.
I remember they gave us ridiculous targets to make before that World Cup. Yeah. And I think only Morne made that target the first morning. And then after that, remember every morning 6 o'clock, if you didn't make it, you've got to wake up again. You've got to run the repeated sprint and then until you make it. I think a lot of guys went to that World Cup without making it.
But needed the team.
But eventually that second morning I just about made it. But those fitness tests are never nice.
And were you naturally fit since you were a light pioneer?
Yeah, I think so. I think I could always run. I was a bit leaner when I started out. I think I made my super rugby debut at 79 kg, so I was like a lich. But a bit heavier now. But I think it's always been a natural ability of being, I can run.
You can still run in your 40s. Yeah. Must be a natural ability if you can run in your 40s, partner.
100%, But also, you moved to overseas as well. You played a little bit at Ulster, especially Ulster. You've been there 7 years. And speaking up to Kutsov a couple of episodes ago, he was so speaking highly of you. And when I played at West, also at Kingspan Stadium, he's got this wallpapers of Ruan Pienaar. Is a legend over there.
Statues.
Like almost in cheetahs. Hey. You're going to bring one. You're going to make one. How was your journey that side? That 7 years? Did you, the adaption moving over and settling in and also playing good rugby?
Yeah, it was a big decision. We had such a strong team and such a great team at the Sharks at that stage, and I was still involved with the box. So it was a difficult decision to make. Johan Miller went to Ulster and I just made a joke with him. I said, listen, if there's a spot at nine, tell them to give me a call. Because I've always wanted to experience that because our careers normally span 10 to 12 years. Mine's a bit longer than usual. But I thought that's going to be my only time to make that change and sort of see what the rugby in the Northern Hemisphere is like. And a couple of weeks later, he phoned me and said, listen, David Humphries from Ulster is going to give you a call if you're still keen to chat to him. I said, yeah, sure. I'm not thinking much of it. And he said one of the scrum-offs are moving to Leinster. So if I'm keen, they're willing to put in an offer and see how it goes from there. I was newly married, so it was a big decision to make and then just pack up and go to Northern Ireland with my new wife. But we decided to go. It was seven incredible years, but I must say the first arrival there was a bit of an eye opener. Yeah, the stadium, which was called Ravenhill back then, was this old stadium. Just the one on the far side was brand new, but the rest old, and behind the post, no stands at all. Yeah. And I thought, what did I get myself into? And the weather is horrible, and the rain comes in sideways, and it was a bit of a but incredible. I can't speak highly enough of Ulster. I really enjoyed it. And for some reason, the fans took to me and the rugby went well and my wife was happy. So I think everything just fell in place and had seven
and
incredible
years. And the rugby
as
well, because you guys played in the final, Heineken final as well against Leinster.
We played 2012 at Twickenham, but unfortunately we lost. But I mean, that Leinster team was special.
It was Brian O'Driscoll and all those boys.
They were just unbeatable at that stage. But what an incredible experience. Packed Twickenham Stadium. Mm. Ulster fans, Leinster fans, just made the whole thing, although we lost, incredibly special.
And Piney, from a weather point of view, right, moving from Durban, Northern Ireland, scrum off, how did you handle that transition? Ball is cold, kicking. Mm. What was that like, especially in the beginning?
Yeah, it was hard. I must say it's going from, I think the one thing that helped, Durban gets so humid, so the ball is slippery anyway. But it was a bit different. But like I said, Belfast is so breezy and it rains the whole time. So you had to adapt your game a little bit, but I think that was the beauty. And one of the things I wanted to go there was to adapt, to grow as a player, to grow as a person, because now you're out of your comfort zone. You've got to change your game somehow. You've got to think differently. And I think everything just clicked and played some of my best rugby for Ulster. So really enjoyed it.
Special.
And the people of Ulster, obviously, they love Ruan Pienaar and Ruan Pienaar love Ulster. It's obviously similar. Let's take life off the field. What was it like living in Belfast? Family, kids, Ruan Pienaar, did you have a pint or what do you
call it? Guinness.
What was life like off the field, especially in Belfast?
It was brilliant. I must say indoors. but the culture, it is a beautiful country. And if you go along the coastal areas, it is Ireland and Northern Ireland. It's incredibly beautiful country. And the people is good. I had a few pints of Guinness, started to enjoy that as well. And later on, my kids were born there, so I think our lives changed a lot. We grew as a family, and I think that's why it's so special as well, like the family and everything. I went there as a newly married couple and then ended up coming back with three kids. So life changed a lot.
Under the blankie.
There's not much to do there, you know. The weather is bad.
But the history there was a high level, because I think they built the Titanic and stuff there. There's a lot of
For knowing that information.
Because I've been there. Played over there. And then French fries. You had some French fries as well. Yeah. Montpellier. How was that journey? Obviously, you had a lot of South Africans at Ulster. When you moved over, you met up with, you know, Bismarck and Jan and the boys. Yeah. And I think Kubus, maybe he was there as well. Jan and them. How was that journey? How was adapting, you know, in France? Because they always say it's tough.
It's tough. Paige would know. The language is difficult. The culture, it's a shock. And especially if you have kids and a family. And, you know, the life we had in Belfast and how to swap it for France, it was difficult. I won't lie to you. The first season was all right. We made it all the way to the top 14 final. Yeah. Unfortunately, lost to Cast. But yeah, it was a bit of a culture shock.
Yeah.
Just the language, being able to go to a coffee shop and just ask for a flat white and a lekker broekie. It was hard. And then my family only spent my first season with me there because the daughter with schooling in France, it was really difficult. So I said, listen, take her back to Belfast. So I moved into a apartment in the city center without the family, which was hard. I had a newborn as well, which hardly slept. So my wife was a bit of a zombie when I saw her a couple of weeks later. But anyway, I think when I look back, there will be a few positives that we can take from it. But it was a bit of a shock. Yeah.
Partner, listening to Pine, it obviously it rekindles a lot of
throwback
for us and my family as well. Pine, when you speak about your little girl, my little girl had the same in class.
Yeah.
So I went there, like a parent meeting thing where you go and see what your kid do the whole day. And my kid was counting on her fingers in French.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And I felt so sorry for her. And that's actually when me and my wife also decided, listen, yeah, this is not going to work. Yeah. I love the game of rugby.
Yeah.
But if you see your kids like that, it's really difficult. When you drop her off, my little one used to cry.
Yeah, mine's the same. Yeah.
Is it?
Oh, no, it was horrible.
It was
so
difficult
bad.
Mornings.
And then their school started 8:30 and you only pick them 4:30 or 5:00.
Yeah.
So in Belfast, they used to finish 2:30 and at least then you can go on a play date or indoor play area or something. Now, you know what it's like. It's suicide hour from 5 to 8 to get your kids fed and into bed and stuff.
Yeah.
And now she can't do anything. No, shame. I really felt sorry for them. But we made the decision. I was supposed to stay there for another season. But then went back to Belfast thinking that was it for me. I'm going to call it a day. Actually started sort of going with a business guy, trying to enter the business world.
Behind the laptop.
What was it like? What was that quick little breeze of business?
It was very quick because it wasn't for me. But I just wanted to see the family happy again. So that was sort of my process. I didn't want to move them to another club in the UK or somewhere again. So I was actually thinking, okay, this is going to be it. I'm going to start the corporate journey and try and get a real job and
start life
start
with
buying
the family.
Suits and and ties and nice shoes to start working. But then call came from South Africa from the Cheetahs and we're back
in SA. Family first at the end of the day. And the support of your wife, Monique, you spoke about it now and you've had three kids, you know. her support, pushing you forward throughout your career. Obviously, it's been a very, very long career. You know, being there for you, game day, making sure everything is prepped and ready for you to perform. What was that support like, having your family behind you? I know in France you didn't have them, but you know, when you got back home, got them together, your mindset in terms of achieving the next?
Yeah, I must. I'm very fortunate. I mentioned my parents and what a big impact they had in their support. But yeah, then my wife, we started dating when I was 19. So she's been through this whole journey with me, from the Sharks, Ulster, Montpellier, back again. So it's great to share all those memories with her. You know what rugby is like.
Yeah,
the highs are high and the lows are very low. Very low. When people start saying bad things about you, don't impact you, but only you, but also your family and your parents and your wife, and eventually you get kids. It's not easy. It's not always sunshine and roses that everyone think it is. So for her to stick with me and keep supporting me, and I get very nervous before games, so I'm a bit grumpy before games, and I don't want to do too much. And eventually you get kids where you're so nervous, now you've got to do ballet and stuff with your daughter 3 hours before kickoff. So I think they've probably bought a bit more of a relaxed feel in the house. But now my wife's been supportive and incredible, so I think it's great when your wife is like that. Then I think the rugby stuff is easy enough.
And then obviously Montpellier didn't work out as you planned, as the family planned, Pioneer. And then the call came from Coach Franks. The Pienaars of Pat Bloem is
too.
Excitement, did you think at the time, what was the mindset? Was it going to be a 2-year stint? Did you think you're going to play until 40 when you accepted that first original deal from the Cheetahs?
Yeah, I don't know. I actually took a long time to make the decision, because although we're South African and I come from Bloem and I grew up supporting the Cheetahs, we were so happy in Belfast, although I thought my rugby career might finish. It was a difficult decision because we were so happy and the kids were born and they were in school and happy. But yeah, then I said to my wife, come, let's give it a go back home with her family,
comfort
my parents. Incredibly grateful for the opportunity to come back to the team that you supported as a boy. And my dad played here. I mean, I just love the Cheetahs and came here as a little boy. It was a difficult decision. Never thought I'm going to play till I'm 40. You guys know a couple of years ago, when you hit 30, that's the end of you. And now to see Dion Fourie making a test debut at 37, Brock Harris, Skalk Ferreira, Willem Alberts, all those guys still playing till their late 30s. It's great to see that the guys are still looking after themselves so well, and that people still see value in older players in the experience.
Oh, I like that part.
And everything they can bring.
I actually like that last part that he said, partner. The value. I'm the same. I like an older head. I like a bit of my experience. A lot of people out there, they like the youth, but I think there's still a really important place for experienced guys within teams.
100%.
And then, Piney, did you think you're going to win 2 Currie Cups?
No, not at my age. I think I was 35 when I came back here. The Currie Cup is such a special tournament. And especially to the Cheetahs. I mean, that's their bread and butter these days. Yeah. So for us, the Currie Cup is the big thing with us not having a Super Rugby or URC to look forward to. It's incredibly special. I love the Currie Cup. I think it's the greatest competition. You guys have played it. It's so special to love that cup and the tradition
and the history about it.
It's awesome. So, it's a special time.
Super memories. You've got 3 Currie Cups, eh?
You've also got a few. You broke our hearts in Durban a few years ago. After I left the Sharks, but it was still tough to see.
You guys took it in 2010, so I had to say, okay, 1-1, now we're equal. Just talking about trophies and stuff, you know, having 3 Currie Cups, but the big one, obviously, in 2007, the Rugby World Cup. Your Springbok memories, you know, growing up, you played under-19, SN-19, SN-21, you know, coming through, playing so early in your career. Green and gold memories for you. How was it like? What can you take away when it comes to memories on and off the field? How special is it? Not only playing for them, but watching them in 2019 World Cup, 2023 World Cup, winning back-to-back, being part of that green and gold?
Yeah. No, it's incredibly special. You guys know too. That's what we grow up wanting to do, is to put on the green and gold jersey. And the first time you see your name on the TV screen and you've been selected for the squad and then eventually making a match day squad, it is incredibly special. I think it's hard to describe, seeing that and then being able to run into the pitch in a massive stadium packed with passionate South African supporters. I mean, That just, I think we've seen that 2019 and again last year, how it unites people. Yeah, and agree. When the box do well or your province do well, everyone's mood is up and everyone's happy. And Ibrahi flies pretty lekker there.
Also lekker.
Yeah, so no, it's, I must say, it was an incredible, incredible experience to be a part of that. And yeah, I just loved every minute.
Finally, I'm sitting and I'm thinking, you play test rugby 9 and fly off. What was that like?
And 15 at all? Sometimes
for some reason, I got picked at 15 for a few as well. No, I mean, I
was it different challenges playing those positions at test level?
Yeah, definitely. Every position's got its different challenges. But yeah, I enjoy playing 10, like I mentioned earlier. But you've got to play there week in, week out to build your confidence, to grow into the position. But I mean, I'm incredibly proud to say that I've played or started test matches in 3 different positions. And then also my beginning years, myself and Francie, Jake White threw us in at wing as well. There's no pace involved as well, but had a few stints there at the wing as well. But
a 9 on the wing.
But it's
normal memories. Now. Back then it wasn't normal.
Because if you look at Grant Williams and Curvis Ryan, it's easy to
name. Now it's normal.
I never had their pace because you know how frustrating it is these days. You see a gap by the time you get there, it's close. And you just pass again. I think that's so hard now because the youngsters are so physical and quick. Like by the time I get there, it's just nothing anymore. So I think that's also the reason why I think it's good to hang up the boots now because the pace just isn't there anymore.
And Piney, the future, you obviously just said now hanging up the boots. Was that the season? How did you come to that decision? Yeah. Was it difficult, the process of it, and obviously the next step for you in your life?
Was it the mind? Was it the hemis? Was it the body?
No, I must say my both actually still feels all right. But look, the knees are a bit sore. The first 5-10 steps in the morning. But I think the last 2 months actually sort of put me in a place where I've got peace with it. I know it's time. I've had a long career. I've been fortunate with injuries, not having too many aches and pains. I think maybe because I played 9, we don't take as much contact as you guys did in the midfield.
I told you.
But I think it's just time. I think I've got peace with it now. And I look back now and I've got great memories, made great friends.
Yeah.
I think the one thing I'm going to miss is all the banter and the nonsense you talk in the changing rooms. I think the match day, you're going to miss playing and preparation during the week, but I think all the nonsense and the banter in the change rooms afterwards and training days, I think that's all the things that you're going to miss most.
100%, yeah. And what's this new journey now for you? Obviously, we've heard that you kind of move on to something. Mm. What do you want to do when you hang up those boots?
Yeah, I think I would love to give coaching a bit of a go. I helped with Great College and the 15s, and I must say I really enjoy going there and working with the youngsters. I love rugby. I've always loved it, and I would love to give something back to a game that's given me so much great memories. And, we're really fortunate to do it as a living. You travel the world, you meet great people, you make great friends all over the world, and for me to get a chance to maybe give something back will be great. But I know it's going to be a different challenge if I get the opportunity. But I'm nervous, but I'm also looking forward to it.
You're not keen for referee? Huh?
Whoa.
He wants to give back, maybe.
I'm looking forward to seeing you, I must say.
No. I think he's going to be the ref when we coaching. I'm like,
I think he's going to do a great job. I think he's going to do a great job.
I think I would love to ref for you guys. Imagine the halftime when you guys come in and you're telling me, Paige, you must stay. You must stay.
Look out for this, hey.
Look out for this, prepping me. Finally, coaching-wise, what side of coaching is giving you the most passion or enjoy? Which part do you want to get into?
I think the skill side of it, I like to see guys grow as players. So that's all aspects, passing, kicking. I think that's probably the two things that I really enjoy the most. But I think as you get to the end of your career, you sort of look how coaches react to certain things, disappointments, losses, wins, and you try and learn of that because you know it's an interest of yours maybe going forward. But I just want to see guys enjoying what they're doing, getting better at what they're doing. And I think I've already learned a lot working with the under 15s here at Great College. You learn a lot about yourself, how to handle things, how to get the best out of them. And I think it's a different challenge altogether than being a player. But I'm looking forward to it, I must say. It's going to be a nice challenge, and hopefully that, I'll do a decent job. But it is stressful as well. But
it
it's
is
gonna
stressful.
Be,
ask me. Yeah, I'm stressful.
At least I'm grey and I've lost my hair. You're going to look gonna a bit different.
In
a couple of years, yeah. In a few years' time, that afro is going to look like Scarra. So.
Yes.
Finally, also like giving back, you coaching, like you said, yeah, for the youngsters, what message do you have for the youngsters out there? You've had a 20-year career. To get to professional rugby, yeah. What to look out for, and how to see themselves going through the career and becoming a Springbok one day?
I think hard work's always going to be one that I mentioned. I don't think there's a substitute for that. You've got to work hard. You've got to be able to be disciplined and work hard and spend the hours. Unfortunately, that is what it is. Yeah. I think then you've also got to be ready when that opportunity comes, because one coach might see potential in you or think you're ready for the big time or give you opportunity. If you're not ready to take it, then you're going to miss out big time. I know I've seen a lot of guys with a lot of talent, and unfortunately for some reason I just missed the boat, and it's disappointing to see guys not reach their full potential. And I think a big one for me again is to be coachable.
Yes, 100%.
I think even at my old age, I tried to look at a DuPont and a Aaron Smith and all those guys who's at the top of the game at the moment, and you still try and look at their technique when they kick, their passing, their decision making. And I think you've always got to be willing to learn and to be coachable. So I think those are three things that I find really important and will make a big difference.
And finally, currently, you're talking about the points and the Aaron Smith and those. Yeah. Let's quickly build our ideal scrum off.
Who's his role model? Huh? Who's the guy that looks...
What would that look like?
Yeah, I think... growing up, Justin Marshall, George Gregg, and Joost van der Wesses, and those were the three guys that stood out head and shoulders for me. And I loved watching their play and learning from them. But I think at the moment, I think Antoine Dupont is something special. He's something he just makes something happen out of nothing. Aaron Smith obviously has been incredible for the All Blacks and for the Islanders. And then if you look at the speed and the stuff of Kobus Reinach and Grant Williams these days. I mean, it's incredible to see how quick they're on. And I think there's a lot of players over the last two decades who stood up and stood out. I think looking local, Pfuri, Bola Conradi, Janu Vermaak, those guys, Enrico Janjari. I think there's so many. And the great Pagey himself. I think I was fortunate to play with and against some of the best agents. Players of their generation. So really fortunate and some good memories.
One of the toughest scrum of guys. You don't play against the toughest guy.
Physical.
Let's say you competed for one or two that you played against that you could say after every game, that guy is he was brilliant. Yeah. Or it was tough to play against.
Yeah, I think locally, Fourie obviously was really good. I think Enrico, yes, he was nagging. You guys played, he was niggly and said and chirped and stuff. I think also Byron Keller, my first few seasons, he was tough and physical and in your face. That was tough. Then you had Will Guinea, all those guys. They were just, Aaron Smith, they were just so good and technically sound. Sure, there's a lot of players, but I always hated playing against a guy that's champion. Maybe I remember I told a story in our first day about Pagey. So we played in Kings Park. I think it was a Super Rugby or Curry Cup game, and I just heard sitting on the stand before our game, and he was captain of the Lions and 21s, I think, or 19.
Yeah.
Man, I heard this guy just talking and chirping and stuff, and it was Pagey.
The one and only.
Yeah.
Yeah, Rakas, I didn't talk a lot, I just had to say, when I had to say something, I did it, but obviously the happened open, so it sounded like I was speaking the whole game. But partner, I didn't.
You didn't. Okay? Imagine running a podcast with this guy.
Must be tough. It's good memories. And great. Yeah, I mean, I played in a great era, and it's great to see all the guys from your junior level seeing reach their success and always going on to good things. Really special.
And at 18-year-old at Grey College, did he ever think he's going to play until the age of 40?
No ways. I must say, I'm very fortunate. My body still feels good. Didn't have many major injuries, odd niggles and stuff. I hurt my knee when I was really young, but everything is still fine.
Yeah.
thankfully, from then. But no, never paid you. Okay. Like I said earlier, when you eat 30 normally, they said you're done. But yeah, I know I've had a great time.
Incredible career.
I won't change anything. Played with great people. I think importantly, played with good people as well. I think the rugby side of it will all fade away eventually. Oh, but the people and who you are. We had a teacher at Great College who said, it's lack of a mens to wees, maar dan moet jy 'n lekker mens wees. And I think that stuck to me. I think all the stuff you, all the trophies and accolades and great memories from rugby is awesome, but I think eventually just the person,
the human,
that's going to stay behind. And I think that always stuck to me. So,
And is there any pain? Was there any cheat code that you used to play for 20, 25? Was it stretching? Was it a healthy diet? What was the trick?
I think it helped that to play nine. Don't take as much contact as these guys in midfield. But I always liked training hard. Off days, I still come in and kick. Even to this day, on an off day, I'm here kicking and working on my game.
And rolling, massage, don't have things?
Massage now and then, stretching. My hamstrings are so tight, I can't touch my toes. I think later on you eventually see, as the game changes, how nutrition can play a part. Jerome, I'm not the biggest guy in the world, but you realize all the importance in all those things. So, I don't think there's a special recipe. I've been fortunate enough not to have many injuries and
Pani, thank you very much for making the time twice.
We have two recordings with Ruan.
Shows what type of man he is. Thank you very much for making the time. The stuff you've done on the field and off the field as well. I mean, you can't remember, I've played, you were my first four ball actually playing a golfish, getting me into the golf. Should have given me more opportunities so I could beat you. Some good memories. But yeah, what a fantastic career you had. I mean, you're doing fantastic job on the field, but off the field as well, as you lead into the coaching. All the best with the Cheetahs. I mean, you and Franz and all the boys, especially when it comes to Cheetahs rugby that played for the Springboks. You know, you've got guys around, in and around Bloemfontein, Tian Lieberberg, they're trying to get the Cheetahs back up there and being into the big five when it comes to SA rugby. Congrats on well done on that and keep working hard and we'll see him again.
And congrats on your recent trophy and your
recent
Currie Cup Player of the Year.
I think they felt sorry for the old guy and just gave it to someone. But no, thank you. But
and 20-year career, so outstanding. And I know the next chapter will be even better, man.
No, thank you. It's great to have you guys here in Bloem. Hopefully we can organize a game of golf soon. Great to chat to you guys. My Engels is no klaar. It's been awesome to have you guys here in Bloem, and hopefully we'll see you back here soon.
We'll come back soon. Guys, that's Ruan Pienaar. Ciao, ciao. Oh, partner.
Oh, wow.
We spent a lot of time with him. Once, twice, three times, a Ruan Pienaar.
Okay, they will put your scenes, all right?
Yes, fantastic,
Worky, excellent.
What a man, what a gentleman, what a rugby player.
And what a nice guy.
He's got some good memories.
Brilliant career, I think one of the legends of South African rugby.
100%.
Partner to be able in that condition, 100%. The way he's currently playing rugby at 40 years old, to win a trophy for Currie Cup Player of the Year at 40 years old.
Lifting a Currie Cup. And he's got his own RWC trophy as well.
Yes.
His medal.
What an incredible. Congrats, Piney.
Congrats
flowers,
alles.
Flowers for you, Piney. Flowers.
Blomme. Brass panties. But fantastic to catch up with him. Obviously, a lot of stuff going through for them as well.
Yes.
Going into the SA Cup as well. So his last couple of games before he calls it. He hangs up the boots.
Yeah, but a brilliant career. Yes, I think we should celebrate the day it is done. We should celebrate a phenomenal career and make sure that we talk about him for years 100%. And years and years and years.
And we're going to have him back.
Yes.
Okay. For one take, but we're going to have him back. Okay.
Do you want to share with the Ruckers what happened?
Hey?
Are we going to spill the beans?
We already told him what happened there. But we'll keep on top of it. All right. The main thing, stay the main thing.
Happy days.
Then partner, then we get to the nitty-gritty stuff. I don't know if you want to talk about this nitty-gritty stuff.
I've got no shame, Ruckers. I've had a few DMs this week. A lot of people sending me stuff. Yeah, last week you were singing on the show in your blue shirt. What happened this weekend?
Did you get it?
Yeah. Paya? I was actually hurt about the amount of, but it's fine.
Rakers, don't be like that, man. Yeah, I know. Don't give
it's fine. Yeah. Die global eet die week van die vloer af.
Okay. But yeah, let's just quickly go through the results while we're on the results. Obviously, we started with the Challenge Cup first, and it was the Sharks versus Edinburgh. And that score, I called it 36-30. So I called it plus. Yeah, so we both got it right, actually, which is also good. But it's good to see the Sharks into the semi-final. Yeah, so fantastic game that was. You know, good to see Shia.
Masuku.
Hey, back-to-back man of the matches.
Shia Masuku in Durban, if you're watching behind the rock, DM,
yeah.
We're ready for you.
Slide in the DMs. And also a congratulations on Grant Williams, 50 caps.
Yes. And another congratulations to Kerwin Bosch on 100 caps.
100 caps, yeah.
Well done, boys. Mm. Lekker.
Incredible stuff, eh? So hopefully we'll be fully behind the Sharks because we want them to win this, okay? We need some...
We need a trophy, especially in Europe. I know they're going to play away from home partner. We'll talk about it later. But Sharkies, behind the rack, also in your corner.
Incredible, yeah. The Boks are playing fantastic rugby. Good to see Eben back.
Always.
And Ethan Hooker doing incredible work. And it's Lock as well, Emil van den Heerden. He's also incredible. Just to see the balance of the Springboks, and it's incredible to see. So Sharkies, all the best. Let's go. And...
No, don't let your mood drop like that. Mm. Say the score. Let's talk about it. We got to do it.
Then obviously, we're on Saturday night at 9 o'clock. We're at Saints against the Bulls.
Mm.
Mm. And what a score that was, actually. What a tough game that was. 59-22. So the Saints gave the Bulls 59 after they gave Leon 59. So thoughts on the game. I'll go to you. Start it off first.
Yeah, partner, obviously, I think the frustration for me is not the actual game. The frustration is we've had the discussion when behind the rack started at the beginning. Sometimes I don't like the B teams and the A teams. And I grew up in an era where we played Super Rugby. It's always the best team.
Mm.
So now there's a lot of A and B. So that was tough for me in the week. I really wanted to see what our A team would have done against the Saints in such an occasional game. Mm. It was difficult. First half, halftime, I was like, hey, is there a surprise on the cards?
This is short.
And then immediately second half, 2 minutes into the... they
straight through, boom, 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 boom.
To blast my kersie uit.
Is it?
Makkelijk.
Kersie uit. But shout out to Saints as well. They played incredible rugby. There's a reason they top in the Premiership. You know, there's a reason they're in the quarterfinals as well. Their set piece, rugby, oh, wow. So credit must go to a lot of those players. Fraser Dingwall, they've got Mitchell as well at 9. Not England starters when it comes to England international rugby, but that team looks like a wild old engine.
A really good brand of rugby they play, yes. Partner. I could obviously...
Options the, 12s and the triangles.
The Bulls backline, the Bulls backline partner struggled tremendously, even just to put a hand on them.
Yeah.
Couldn't touch the screen, anybody. So that was very good, especially I think if you're a coach, I would think that was really good on the eyes, the way they manipulated that first phase attack. But from the Bulls, you could understand the players, they ran out of juice in that second half. They haven't played in a long time. So no game time.
They might be a bit rusty as well. So, and the plane wasn't that...
Eight
planes, okay.
Listen. But you would want in a game like that, that's just my point of view, partner, best against best.
Mm.
I want to see the Willy, the Kanan Moody's, the Kirtley Aronson, the Marcel Kutsias, like front up against the best of England, and we eat them.
Agree, yeah, but at the end of the day, you've got a full squad. And I mean, for Jake, that might be the best. So at the end of the day, shout out to, you know, every team's got a plan. You know, every team's got a plan who to play in the quarterfinals. So it wasn't nice for European rugby to say they must play the A team and whatever. What message is out there for the other youngsters? That's a second option, third option, all those type of things. So I must still good effort going out there, playing at 9 o'clock at night, having a tough travel as well, trying to get the result and knowing you have to go to Leinster, and Leinster has been performing well. But shout out to the Bulls. They've done incredible. Now they can just focus on the URC. Mm. And in the URC, everyone needs that cup. Everyone's going at the cup.
I think I disagree with you, Paria. Mm,
yes, talk to me.
I think the Heineken Cup is way more prestigious than the URC.
Mm.
URC is domestic rugby. URC is international. The Investec Champions Cup is international rugby. So I think as a fan and as a rugby lover, I would rather have the Investec Champions Cup where you go away to a full-strength Leinster and you beat them at home. Then, but that's just me.
But my other point is also, they probably knew they have to go to Leinster. okay, to beat them in the semi-final away from home. Then they have to go to one of the other teams as well in France or England to also play tough and then focus on the URC. So yeah, Jake and them and the URC boys, they've got it covered. But yeah, just a lot of like, lot of talk around when it comes to the URC and the Champions Cup. But all the best to the boys. Hopefully they can pull it through. But let's park the Range Rover, put it away, and bring out the Chrissy Dyke. Okay? Let's get to our fixtures quickly. Okay? So there's four good games, especially our teams that's going to play, you know, we're going to start up with the first one. The Sharks are going away, actually. They're going to Glasgow Warriors. So Glasgow Warriors versus the Sharks, Friday at 8:35. And let's go through other teams as well. Let's cover all of them. Then the next day, it's obviously Saturday, which is the Lions versus Leinster.
Okay.
Okay, that's Saturday at 3 o'clock. We've got the Bulls versus Munster. Munster defending champions coming down to the Bulls at 17:05.
Okay.
And then the last game, Stormers versus Ospreys at Saturday, 7:15. It is, yeah.
Home or away for the Stormers?
Stormers at home.
Stormers at
it's
home.
Only the Shark is going away. Just the overview of all the teams leading into the Cressida now. What do you think about the chances quickly of the Sharks, the Lions, the Bulls and the Stormers?
I think from a chances point of view, obviously the Bulls and the Stormers they're in a really good spot. Mm-hmm. They have everything under control. Their destiny is in their own hands. So hopefully the Bulls obviously made a strong statement and a point that they're targeting the URC. So I'm expecting all of our superstars to be back this weekend against Munster. So Munster, Slarkies.
Slarkies, yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
Munster key? Mm. Okay.
And the Shark is going away. What should the mindset be?
That's why I'm so confused, Paddy. With all this B team, C team, A team.
Yeah,
who's resting? Who's playing? I don't even know who's going to be on the plane for the Sharks, to be totally honest, partner.
Because they flew the next day, so there's always stuff.
Yeah. So it will probably be... I really don't know, because in 3 weeks' time, they got to play at the Stoop in a European game. So are you just going to stay there for 3 weeks?
Yeah,
or are you going to fly players
up
in and out?
Down, up and down, yeah.
So I am confused on that, what they're going to do. But I really think the Sharks has turned the boat around.
Yeah.
So I expect a better performance.
I expect them all just to go over, enjoy it, enjoy.
Play
a bit, get yourself ready for when it comes to that semi-final spot. And we want a trophy. We want a challenge.
Actually, on the Sharky selection point of view, I would love Plum to give Grant Williams 3 or 4 games in a row to play. I want Grant Williams to play a bit.
Yeah.
Every time he comes on, there's a
massive
quick,
difference.
It's a massive
it's
difference.
The speed of play. The KPA
absolutely.
Is the QB, quick ball.
So I think
alive.
Grant, I would love to see Grant getting 60 minutes instead of 20. So from a Sharks point of view, selection point of view, I think that Stormers at home against Ospreys, Stormers will...
We need five. We need
you guys
five.
Had a week off. I don't know the injuries you guys had and how long that injuries would impact the team, but I can see the Stormers bouncing back, being refreshed, being energized and ready to eat post-breakies.
It's a lot of injuries that we have, especially the big one, Dion Fourie, that's got a long knee injury. But also the other boys as well. Once you have a concussion, you're going to be out now for about 3 weeks, 21 days. So it's a bit of a long journey if you return to action. But yeah, it's a crucial one to get this one over the line, because Leinster is coming down as well the following week. And yeah, they might send a B team, A team, doesn't matter. But we need to get 10 points just to make sure we get to the playoffs. But not only the playoffs, get to the number one spot in South Africa.
Well, come on, seatbelt, please, sir. Rakers, sorry, my partner's out of control again.
I'm talking from Cape Town.
Okay.
Cape Town's point of view.
Okay.
Yeah. So overall, the boys are looking good. Hopefully the three home games for South African teams will be nice and awesome. The Lions, it's important to get one over Leinster.
Come on, come on.
Because we want top 8. We want Investec Champions Cup. Yes. And all top 8, and also there's a chance. Because if you look at number, say 11 to number 8, they're all in this 1.2, 0.3 points. So it's a lot to ride on for the Lions, yeah.
I think it's important, partner. I know we're going to move on to the Lulabet predictions now. But for our teams to have home ground advantage in the playoffs.
Mm.
So if the Bulls and the Stormers need to win these games, it's very important for both franchises.
And we've seen it's important to get home final, home semis and home final. Okay, Munster, I don't know how they got quarterfinal, semifinals, and final away and get it. But yeah, to win a competition, you need that home semifinal and final. Yeah. And while we get talking about the fixtures, let's get to our Lulabet predictions. Here we go. Start with that first game, Sharks away versus Glasgow Warriors. What do you think? What's going to happen at Friday, 8:35?
Yes, but this is difficult. Is it the Sharks Springboks going or... I'm going to go for Glasgow. I'm going to go Glasgow at home. They also going for top of the log. Yeah. I'm going to go Glasgow by 4 points.
Me too. Also Stoke, man. We're a bit Stoke, yeah. So I'm also going to go Glasgow with seven points, yeah. Just thinking, okay, they probably have also time off now. And I mean, the Kyle Steyn and Hugh Jones and everyone's going to be back. And it's going to be tough. So late at night there, it's quite a tough outing, yeah.
So Glasgow by seven?
Yeah, but Glasgow by seven it is. And Lions versus Leinster.
I'm going to go Lions by seven.
Lions by seven.
I don't like the look you gave me. Mm-hmm. I'm going to back the Lions. Mufasa and the boys, guys in Joburg, listen to me quickly. This week, we put everything together.
Yes.
This week, we make sure that Leinster feels the wrath of a lion.
Yes. Scar.
Lions by seven.
Scar and Ainas. Take him away. Okay, get him away out of the things. Get him out of the Lion King. Oof. Paige, you got me in sixes and sevens.
That means
you got me on the fence.
That means you're going with Leinster.
Hey. I'm going to back the Leinster, yeah. I'm so sorry, Lions, but I think Leinster is going to pull it through with 5 points. That's what the... if it's an A team, it's going to be the score will be high. But yeah, if it's a B team, still Leinster.
5-5.
Okay. Is, yeah. Okay, moving on to the Bulls versus Munster. Defending champions, Bulls coming back home at Loftus. What?
Tough game, but at altitude with all our Springbok back, it's an easy Bulls. I'm going to go Bulls by 10 plus.
Yep, Bulls by 10.
Nice. Easier.
So I'm also going to go Bulls by 10. I'm going to be in your boat. Same in for nice. Bluetooth 2 high-fives. Okay.
Like
so plus 10 for the Bulls. Yeah, just because, I mean, coming back now after what happened last week, they're going to turn that corner around and then steamroll.
Let's
down the hill, yeah. Last game, Ospreys. Okay, Stormers, Ospreys at the DHL Stadium. What do you think?
Stormers by 15.
Yeah.
Stormers by 15. I think the Stormers will be way too good for the Ospreys. Mani, Gaza and them getting back to their best.
Know the importance of this game. They know the importance of the next game. I agree with you. I'm going to say Stormers by 12.
Nice.
Yeah,
well 12, done.
By 12. Yes.
Okay.
Going to be on and guys, that is the Lulabet predictions.
Nice.
Hey, yeah. So we're going to see what's going to happen this weekend. Incredible rugby waiting for us.
Big game, but I think partner from my side, just it was for me excellent to speak to Ruan Pienaar and be at the Toyota Stadium
yeah,
at the Toyota Free State.
And thank you very much for making time for these two rugby players, huh?
Yeah, and he was obviously the guy's an absolute legend, and we got just the insight into what he thought and how he enjoyed certain stuff. So, Rakers or sort of like.
Or sort of like. Oh,
yeah.
Clear yellow net Iraks. Not the lady Iraks. Like, share, and subscribe, and
clear the rack.
Clear the rack. Yeah, that's what we want to see. So fantastic. Hey, I'm excited. For
I'm excited,
weekend.
Partner. And always, I'm going to make a special thanks and mention, guys, to our sponsors that make sure the lights stay on at Behind the Rack, that we stay on the line. Our Behind the Rack is officially powered by Kruger International. Asset and Wealth Management. They're now exclusive betting partner, Lulabet, that's been over Juan Z for the past 40 episodes. The OGs, thank you so much for your continuous support. And our new apparel partner
Classroom.
And sponsor, Old School. Thank you for coming on board and making sure that we look really good and you guys walk the journey with us. Old School. So go check them out, guys. They are our new official apparel partner. Big deal.
Okay. So guys, hey, Rackers, make sure you like, share and subscribe and clear the racks like always, man.
Yes.
You're doing fantastic work. We got Rakkers from all around the world. There's Rakkers in Bloemfontein as well. Can you believe it? They come to me in the mall and be like, hey, I'm a Rakker. Yes. Believe that. So thank you very much for all the support. Jump in our comment sections and make BTRs. Keep them alive and keep them powered up. Eh?
Yeah? Absolutely.
Fantastic, partner.
Chicken wrap.
Chicken wrap it is. So guys, I'm Juan de Jong.
I'm Rudy Pates.
And the rack is clear.
Bye-bye.